So my talk's going to be on continuous deployment, even though today is named continuous delivery. Whoops, they invited me to the wrong conference. So my name is Timothy Fitz. I coined continuous deployment. I was looking it up. It was at Barcamp Block in 2007 that I actually first used the term continuous deployment. I did so while I was a technical lead at IMVU. We were a startup, we did continuous deployment. I just coined it, I didn't invent it, I didn't start it. There were other companies doing it before IMVU. I have some references to Flickr doing it early 2004, late 2003. And there were a lot of trends leading to this. I just sort of pointed at, hey, continuous integration can go one step further. That's in fact where the term continuous deployment came from. Why don't you integrate and then deploy? After IMVU was a CTO at Canvas, I actually got to build this from scratch at a company and hire up people who knew nothing about it and teach them. And in fact, we got to have a venture capitalist, Fred Wilson, who had already continuously deployed at Etsy before he joined our board, which I never would have imagined. And then for the last 5 years, I've been a software consultant. About half of my time, I write code because I'm the kind of person who, if I don't write code, I go crazy. And the other half, I teach and evangelize and do lessons and workshops and coaching around continuous deployment. You can find me at timothyfitz.com or timothyfitz on Twitter. These slides are available already online if you go to my Twitter and look into that. So really quickly, I'm going to cover what is continuous deployment, how is it different from continuous delivery. That's sort of the basic part of this talk. Then I'm going to talk about the pitfalls of getting to continuous deployment. So sort of the lessons learned that I've seen from organizations where they get stuck or they have problems, things I don't like that the industry is doing right now. Lots of very opinionated sort of ranty style things. So that's a little bit more intermediate. And then finally, I want to end on the future of continuous deployment, where I think the industry is headed, what I think we're going to see develop, where some opportunities are. And that's sort of like what keeps me up at night, and it's a little bit more advanced. So let's start with the definition of continuous delivery. So the goal is to produce software in short cycles, ensuring that the software can be reliably released at any time. This is pulled from Wikipedia. If you look at, for instance, like the Mark Fowler page on continuous delivery, it's a much longer explanation. But I'm really highlighting sort of the difference between continuous delivery and continuous deployment here. It can be reliably released. So I would say this is deployable at the push of a button. That's sort of the difference between continuous delivery and continuous deployment. I see Jez nodding, so okay, I got it right. We're good. Here, I use terms deploy and release very specifically, and in the classic box model of software, they were the same thing. You know, you would ship a thing, you deploy it, you release it, those were all the same term. But very quickly, you're going to find that deployment is something very specific. It's copying the code out to servers, to client devices, it's running that code, and it's not necessarily releasing new features. Release is when a feature is turned on for a user, when they first see it. For many things, deploy and release are the same, even in continuous deployment. But for bigger features, you're obviously going to want to do something different. So what is continuous deployment? So my definition is safe, automatic deployment of frequent, small commits. You have these things, you're doing continuous deployment. So safe. The automated process is ultimately responsible for failures. So this means that you are not personally going to get blamed. You're not going to sit in a post-mortem and have someone say you're fired for screwing up and committing that bug. No. It is the process that actually guarantees the safety of this. And this isn't just a tool or a technology. It's a way of looking at the people in your company. When you look at safety as an industry, as a sort of set of principles, there's a whole bunch of practices that our industry just doesn't do. You'll hear a programmer say, I got burned by that. That hurt when I did that. That failure cost me. And these are terms that in the safety industry you'd be like, oh, you got burned by that? We should probably have protective gear for you. We should probably ensure the safety of your day-to-day workings. And in the software industry we go, oh no, just do more of that and faster. Don't worry about it, get burned more. No, continuous deployment is about safety. First and foremost, we're seeing it time and time again. We're seeing it in statistics, we're seeing it in studies. When people feel safe, and it is a feeling, first and foremost, when people feel safe, they do better work. And continuous deployment is about making that happen. It's also about automatic deployment, not just automated deployment. So automatic is what happens when I commit code and I don't have to think about it, it gets deployed. Now usually that means I commit, test run, it passes, okay, gets deployed instantly. But I've seen this work just as well, where for environmental factors, the deployment couldn't happen more often than a certain amount of time, every 2 hours, every 4 hours. Maybe the deploy takes an hour or so, maybe it's slow, maybe there's some bureaucratic process. But getting to automatic here is really, really important. Because it means there's no human process. There's no human chance for failure. There's no decision-making process in when and what to release. And so those decisions can't be made for it. And frequent small commits. The smaller your unit of work, the cheaper it is to build out a good deploy pipeline, and the less failures you're going to see. If I commit 10 or 20 or 30 lines of code and they go wrong in production, I just regret them. I don't even think about it. If I'm landing 2 weeks worth of changes and something goes wrong in production, now I have a problem. I can't revert. There are schema changes applied. I don't know what's going wrong. I don't know which line it is. 2 days later, when I finally debug it, what do? I revert 2 weeks plus 2 days worth of changes? No. The smaller these changes are, the better they are for everything. And it doesn't just make things simpler to debug. It decreases the latency. So I have an idea, I build a short thing, I deploy it, I see that it fails in production, I change the way that I was going to build the rest of the feature. And really decreasing that latency and getting that feedback cycle to go very quickly is super, super important. It's a big part of continuous deployment. So I'm going through this pretty fast because I've said this many, many times in other forums. So if you have questions or whatever, just tweet at me and I'll try and send you links to what I have already said or published. So really, really high level, continuous delivery is push button, continuous deployment is automatic. They have sort of the same structure otherwise, and in fact, the best practices of continuous delivery are almost the best practices of continuous deployment. The only difference is you have to push a button between test and deploy. I also want to let you in on a little secret. I view the origin place of continuous deployment, where I went sort of learned and scaled it up and got to understand how it works. It was actually continuous delivery. So tests would pass, but then you had to shell into a machine and type IMG push. We did this because people would commit code and then like go to coffee, and their code would deploy and have problems, and they weren't around, and you couldn't ask them to fix it, and they didn't notice, and they didn't go back. It was problematic, so we didn't have the institutional confidence to actually do continuous deployment. But in practice, during business hours, we were committing 6, 8, 10 times an hour easily. And so this was being run so frequently that if I didn't run it during business hours, someone else would. And so it felt very much like the continuous deployment that I've been evangelizing and that has worked now everywhere else. So let's just keep this a really, really tight, well-kept secret between us. Sound good? Both, also I'm not gonna say delivery and deployment anymore because they sound almost exactly the same. So I'm gonna try and say push button and automatic. Hopefully that'll stick a little better. Both require a fully automated deploy, and that's expensive to build. Both require significant test coverage, and that's expensive to build. You don't necessarily need great test coverage to start, but you're going to get there over time. You're going to be spending a large fraction of your development on writing automated tests. And both require deploy pipeline infrastructure. And between the three of those, that's a lot of work. That's most of what people see and say, okay, continuous deployment or continuous delivery is too expensive for me. I can't afford to do it right now. I can't get management buy-in to build this. So when you talk about either of these concepts, you're talking about mostly the same amount of investment. And that's gonna play into why I think everyone should stop targeting continuous delivery and instead always target continuous deployment. So one of the first problems I see with push button deployments is that they grow a human QA step before deploy. If they don't start with it, it happens very quickly because it's so easy. There's a person there pushing the button. Why don't they test the app? Why don't they just do one core behavior? Why don't they do three core behaviors? And this sets up a really bad feedback cycle. Oh, hey, there was a bug in production. We slipped a change to one of our core behaviors, and we didn't test it before we hit that button. So we run a postmortem, we have a meeting, we look around, we say, how could we caught that? Oh, I could just try that. I could just try our application every time before I push the button. That's not that hard. And so we add more humans to it. Now here's the problem. That's pushing us further and further away from our ideal of low latency. And that's pushing us further and further away from our ideal of automating these things. And inevitably, it leads to more bugs. So I've added a human factor into our process that wasn't there before. I'm relying on it to catch serious issues. And humans, I don't know if you know this about humans, but they make mistakes. And it turns out that a developer at like 2 a.m. trying to push out a hotfix makes all of the mistakes, every single one you could possibly make. And so what you see is more bugs happening as you slow this process down or as you add more human QA. And then you have reduced confidence in your deploy. And this is what really kills. Better version of Keynote, that's the best transition. More bugs lead to reduced confidence, lead to less frequent deploys. And this is by far out of every single mistake that I've seen made at the numerous companies. And I've consulted for 2, 3, 4 person startups, and I've consulted for Fortune 500 global conglomerates. And I see the same pattern of mistakes. So more bugs leading to reduced confidence, leading to less frequent deploys, pushing you further and further away from the ideals of continuous delivery and giving you more and more of the problems of traditional software. Now, one of the really non-intuitive things about continuous delivery or deployment is that it's much harder to ship a weekly release than it is to ship 10 releases a day. Because on a weekly release, if there's a bug, I have to look at a week's worth of changes to figure out what's wrong. And odds are something's wrong. It's been a whole week. Versus I just committed and it instantly went live. Very easy to see what it was that caused it. Very easy to do accounting. Very cheap to do debugging. And so the slower process tends to get slower over time. And the automatic fast process tends to stay fast. And that's really the crux, is that if you have this feedback cycle, if you have the feedback cycle that, and we restarted it off. If you have the feedback cycle that says, okay, we had a bug and we're going to automate the solution to this, we're only going to consider automated solutions to finding that bug in the future, to preventing that class of failure. That actually leads to increased throughput, increased confidence in the system, the ability to do more deploys. Kind of counterintuitively, if you have a broken process, I can give you continuous deployment. Maybe it's just in the staging, maybe it's just in the test. And as long as you agree with me to only add automated things to that process, you will get better over time instead of worse over time. I don't need to do anything else. Usually when I'm brought into a team and they say, okay, how do we get to continuous deployment? I'm like, all right, I'm going to talk to you guys for 2 hours, and then we're going to sit down and we're going to start building. Because the faster I set up this feedback cycle, the less work I have to do. I don't have to tell you how to automate a solution to find a class of bug. You're good programmers, you're good developers, you'll figure that out. That's how IMVU got to where it is. That's where everybody else, when you see these presentations about fantastic test platforms and amazing sort of edge case testing and all these advanced things, they got there by like 3 or 4 years of doing this. Hey, we found a bug. How do we find that automatically? I need to build a tool to solve that. It's easy when you have a concrete problem to build a concrete. Another problem with push button is that deploy often becomes feature release in a push button system. And conflating those two is very problematic. So what happens if I, in a continuous delivery or a push button system, I want to release this new feature, so I commit the final lines of that feature onto master. But then I need to get like the marketing communication side of things settled out. So it takes me about a day. What happens if there's an emergency in the middle of that day? How do I deploy? Well, it turns out I'm accidentally not releasable. We can go live with the feature. We can rush it out. I've seen that happen. That doesn't play off very well, especially when you're trying to release a new feature and fix a bug at the same time. Probably a critical bug, because otherwise you would just have a code freeze. And so this leads to sort of hidden, unreleasable moments. You have an automatic process, you just can't do that. As soon as you commit it, it's going to go live. So you can't commit things that aren't ready. So automatic forces you to use feature flippers. Now, if you're not familiar, feature flippers can be as simple as an if statement. What you're doing is you're saying release is now controlled by software. It can be whatever we want. We have a 19-step feature release process where every person in the company gets to individually sign off and turn the key. That's fine. You can automate that. I don't care. You get to pick. But what it does is it changes it into software, and it means that we can deploy anytime we want. And we know that features aren't going to go live because they're hidden behind these feature flippers. But can't you just use feature flippers with push button deploy? Like, isn't a feature flipper like one of the gold standard practices in continuous delivery? Yeah, it totally is. But here's what I find happens. Without this feedback cycle, without this loop, you have a top-down approach to feature flippers. I see this pattern with all of the sort of best practices in continuous delivery. Someone says, hey, feature flippers are great. They would solve this problem. Let's make sure you use them every time you need to. And then you have a bunch of developers that are excited and try to use them with the best effort. And you have a couple of lagging users or developers who just don't want to do it and resist it. Oh, that's stupid. I don't want to write if statements. And there is a lot of resistance to what I call scaffolding code. Code that you write while you're delivering a feature, while you're releasing it, you rip out later. Because it makes your code look worse. And without that scaffolding code, it would look better. And so there's definitely developer pushback. And so you have to fight that battle. Versus with an automatic deploy, developer sits down to start working on a feature that's not ready yet, and they go, oh crap, I can't do this. I can't do this or I will cause bugs in production. And so now the developer is asking you, what's a solution to this problem? And you can point at feature flippers. This is a much, much, much better model. This is something I think about a lot when designing processes, when matching them to organizations. I think about it in terms of push and pull. Methodology is pushed if adoption is optional and driven by evangelism, and it's pulled if adoption is mandatory and driven by necessity. I was into continuous integration very, 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 very early. I worked on BuildBot, one of the first open source CI servers. I didn't do a whole lot with it. I was in high school. But it was very interesting to me. And so when I finally got into the industry and I started working, I was like, okay, I'm gonna show everyone how to do continuous integration. And everyone's gonna write tests, and it's gonna be great. And we're gonna have a CI server, and it's gonna run. And what did I find? Every time I would try and push that in an organization, about half of the people would adopt it. And they would have a relatively positive experience. And the other half would hate it and never adopt it. And you cannot do continuous integration if it's half adopted. And I found the story was repeated everywhere. You would have test practitioners who loved tests, and people thought that it was a personal preference. Oh, you're just a person who loves tests, you'll write them. I'm not, I won't write them. Oops, I broke your code repeatedly, my bad. Tons and tons of stress. So if you're trying to drive adoption of something, find a way to pull it out of the organization instead of pushing it into it. Adoption will go much, much faster. Switching gears a little bit to the next sort of pitfall I see in continuous deployment. Service-oriented architecture. IMV was a little service-oriented, but it was basically a monolithic code base that got deployed to multiple targets. It wasn't what you think of as a sort of modern service-oriented architecture. And so we didn't have a lot of these problems. It was something that I got to learn about more as I built Canvas and as I consulted elsewhere. And so in a service-oriented architecture, you often have multiple deploy pipelines. So you have a commit that moves from commit to build to test, and then we have the little push button, and we wait a little bit, and we push that button, and now it's live. Everything's great. We can deploy a few things in parallel. This looks really nice. Except here's what's actually usually happening. I need to build a feature, and it needs to touch both the back end and the front end. And so I commit both of those changes. They start walking through their respective deploy pipelines. And then they sit here. Now, probably I'm on the front end team, or I'm on the back end team. There's another team that owns pushing a button to the other service. Maybe I can talk to a couple stakeholders. Maybe I don't know who can push the button. And what I've seen happen, usually this happens once or twice and then people figure it out, is that the button gets pushed in the wrong order. And the front end change goes out live first. And now we're broke. And so service-oriented architecture presents an interesting wrinkle and complication to continuous delivery and continuous deployment. So what do you actually have to do? Well, you have to commit to the back end first. And you have to watch that go out. And then you have to wait while you figure out who can push the button. Is it time to push the button? Have we waited 2 days? Whatever our delivery cadence is. And then finally it goes live. Now, and only now, can I actually just commit that change. And so I've been holding another change off on a branch or locally on my laptop. And then that could finally go out, and then we have maybe another waiting period before we push the button. Then we finally have it. This gets slow and complicated and frustrating. Because I can turn around and push the button on my front-end service, back-end service, and accidentally ship your commit too early. And the answer generally tends to be, let's add more human processes to fix this. But that was way too simple of an example. No one has service-oriented architecture with 2 services.
Yeah,
in the real world, it's like 5 or 15 or 500.
Yeah.
They just seem to grow. Plus, you've got databases. Like, a database is basically another service that has another deployed pipeline. People push schema changes out. They have to go out first. And so you end up in a world that looks a lot more like this. And this is a world that makes me sad. I don't hate service-oriented architecture. I mean, as an application designer, as an architecture person, it's great, it has a lot of advantages. But people who think about service-oriented architecture are often not the same people thinking about deployed pipelines. And that's a problem, because the naive way of doing service-oriented architecture ends up with this, a whole bunch of deployed pipelines. Now, automatic deploy makes this nicer, because I can commit to the back end and probably it'll be deployed before I'm actually starting working on the front end. And I can sort of work at my own pace. That makes things a lot nicer. And so if you're going to do service-oriented architecture, I highly, highly recommend you do continuous automatic deploy. But now you end up with this other problem, which is that you've got 5 deploy pipelines. That's really expensive. How do you actually maintain writing great automated deploys with production monitoring and automatic rollbacks and all of the like great automatic deploy practices? It's too expensive. I've had startups come to me and they go, well, we've got 4 engineers and 12 services. How do we do continuous deployment? Well, hire 8 engineers or get rid of 8 services. There's no way you can afford to do 12 continuous deployment pipelines with 4 people. That's nuts. And inevitably, they go, okay, never mind, continuous deployment's not right. And that makes me a little sad. So here are options. One is templating. So you say, okay, here is how we do our deploy pipeline, and everything is going to roughly fall into this. Sometimes this means standardizing on language or framework across different services. And developers hate that. The reason that developers themselves often want service-oriented architecture is so that they get to pick their own personal favorite framework or language or tool chain. And that's really expensive. That's an antisocial behavior. That says that I want to choose my things over the expense of everyone else who will eventually have to learn all of the different tools and technologies in our application. Now that doesn't mean you can't have more than one language. What it means is you need to pick those, considering social factors, talking to multiple people on the team, and understanding that it's an extra cost at the deploy pipeline. My favorite system is a unified deploy pipeline. As much as possible, figure out which of your services are close to each other, talk to each other frequently, and unify them so you have a single build pipeline that eventually deploys to multiple services. This means that you can share code across those services very easily because they're all building out of a single repository. It also means that, as a developer, I'm not afraid of touching back-end services, even though I've been a front-end developer the whole time, because I know how the system works. I've watched it happen, and I've done these deploys. This is what we built out at Canvas, and we hired a new engineer, and after a few months, they had made a change to one of the back-end services. They didn't even know it was a different service. They weren't even aware. This worked so seamlessly, they weren't aware of the complications that were being hidden. The next thing that I want to talk about, another bad habit, bad pattern I see, staging environments. So in a nutshell, staging environments are a sign of fear of your deployed. Just take a photo of one slide. Staging environments are a sign of fear. They say, okay, our process is not yet good enough to go out. Similar to push button deploys. Our process is not yet good enough. And it has the same problem. Staging environments suck. The shared mutable state. Shared mutable state is terrible. The shared mutable state across multiple teams, across multiple deploy pipelines. So I'll go into a larger organization and there'll be four or five teams and they'll tell me, oh yeah, we're doing continuous delivery. Oh yeah, we're doing continuous deployment in this staging. That is not continuous delivery, continuous deployment. And what's worse is, because staging is so bad, have mobile users, nobody's actually touching it. We don't even know if it works right now. You know, maybe there's 10, 20 developers using it, maybe there's 50 customers who have asked to be alpha testers. But at the end of the day, staging can be broken overnight and no one will notice. And it's broken regularly. Constantly I see, oh, ops needs to test a new package, so they just pushed the change into staging. It turns out it didn't work, but don't worry, they're going to fix it in 4 or 5 hours. So that wouldn't be too bad if you just said, okay, staging is usually broken, we're going to try to push to staging, but then we're going to go live after that. But that's not what happens. What happens is another negative feedback loop. People deploy to staging, staging is broken. Maybe it was the change, maybe it wasn't the change, maybe it's a configuration issue with staging, maybe staging has hardware that's different from production. Myriad of issues cause this. And it leads to less confidence in deploys. And the crappy part here is if you just push that change live, it probably would have worked. You could have skipped staging. So instead of staging, what should you do? Well, I'm not saying don't run integration tests, obviously. You want to run your code in as real of an environment as you can before you actually go live in production. Whatever that means, running on real physical Android hardware or running in the cloud exactly the same way as your production hardware is. But you need it to be isolated, first and foremost. Only tests should have access to the environment, at least while the tests are running. It's nice to be able to pull this aside and debug it afterwards. You have to be able to recreate it automatically, 100%. And ideally, you do so on every single test run. Now, I know that in certain environments, that becomes very prohibitively expensive. So do it daily or weekly. Stand that environment up. But don't give developers direct access to that environment. Don't give operations direct access to that environment. Don't let it turn into a second-class citizen. If someone goes into your staging and changes the schema by hand, when are you going to find that out? When you try and commit code and it breaks. And that's an awful, awful, awful feedback loop. The other nice thing is when you look at this, when you've got 4 or 5 teams that previously were all going into staging and now have their own mini environment being stood up by their test pipeline. So now they get to test against everyone else's known good revision instead of everyone else's broken revision. Because they get to pick what versions they actually pick up and test with. And so that leads to a dramatically better pipeline, a dramatically better organization. The worst part about this is the blame cycle. Because it's always somebody else's fault that staging is broken. And this just leads to incredible, incredible stress and really negative cross-team interactions. And those cross-team interactions are valuable. If you can't ensure that they're often positive, you're going to have a very dysfunctional software. And I see this often come down to just staging or not. It makes a difference in how it feels to be on a team. Switching topics again. I promise I'll tie it all back together. Git. Git is one of the things that's changed since I first started talking about continuous deployment. Is Git bad? I use Git every single day. I kind of like it. I kind of hate it. It's got a whole bunch of issues. There's one really specific problem. when it comes to continuous deployment. Branch-based workflows, pull requests, and code review, that's not even continuous integration. Woo! I spent too long on this, I'm sorry. That's kind of that crying, because you guys aren't doing continuous integration like 20 years later. It's two steps back for the industry. Now, don't get me wrong. The GitHub flow model, branch-based workflows, those are really, really good for open source software. When I was working on Twisted, when I was working on BuildBot, they called it UQDS, Ultimate Quality Development System. And it was like 10,000 lines of shell scripts that scripted Subversion and Track so that you could do branch-based workflows that were connected to tickets that got merged after code review. It was the GitHub flow model in 2005. And it's great for open source software. But open source software is not what you're probably doing day to day. You're probably at a corporation. You probably work with a team that you know. You're probably going to continue to work with that team. You probably work out of a single master branch. You probably don't accept contributions from 1,000 strangers every year. You probably have a single place that you deploy to or a few known deploy targets. And you probably want to get your code deployed as fast as possible because you have a high level of quality with everything. And under those circumstances, branch-based workflows don't make sense. So what's the solution? Never branch. The only time that branching makes sense is when you're spiking or prototyping code that you're going to throw away. You're going to just get rid of. If you're going to write code and it's going to live in production, then you need to do it using continuous deployment. And you need to commit it frequently and regularly so that you can integrate it with everyone and everyone else can integrate with you. Again, this isn't even continuous deployment, this is continuous integration. I'm just telling you what Kent Beck said a long time ago. So then that always brings up the question, what do we do about code review? Are you saying get rid of code review? And I'm definitely not saying that. There's a lot of good uses of code review. But there's also a lot of bad ones. And the reason that people usually want branch-based workflows is because it catches bugs, and it means that terrible engineers can commit code, and you can somehow magically turn that into good code. And both of those things actually kind of make sense in an open source world. But again, in a closed source, in a corporate development environment, and a small team's working on a project, it actually doesn't make sense. If your code review is catching bugs, you have serious problems. And those are further up the pipeline. If you can automate catching those bugs, then everyone can work dramatically faster. Because what's the turnaround time on this? How fast are you actually getting code reviews done? Even really good organizations like GitHub, I mean, they're deploying all the time. They would say they're doing continuous delivery, and who am I to argue with them? But they do this model. And the only way it works is because they have hundreds of engineers that are all just picking up code review. And so their throughput is acceptable, but still surprisingly slow. They still have the problem where someone will accidentally have a branch open for 2 or 3 weeks, and then have integration issues. And then try and land it, try and land too much code all at once, and try and push a couple thousand lines of code out through a process designed for a couple hundred lines. And then they start to have all the problems of the non-continuous world. In practice, this ends up being like a week. 2 or 3 days to write code, do a pull request, get a code review, have to fix stuff. That took a couple days because everybody was busy and code reviews get deprioritized because everyone wants to work on features and move their Scrum tickets along. Put a little Scrum note for doing code review. So it just falls behind, and your latency increases. Everything I'm telling you about here is about reducing latency, because reducing latency makes everything better. Do not do this. So, how do you actually do it? Oh, we have to watch something now. How do you actually do code review? You can do it after deployment. It turns out this works really, really well. There's a bunch of human-level factors that I don't know how to automate. I don't know how to automate readability. I think at the point that we can automate ensuring readability, I'm out of a job and AI has already taken over the planet. So until then, code review is still useful for these human factors. Promoting knowledge sharing, minimizing your bus number, making sure that there's no aspect of your application that only one person understands. All of these can be done with code review after deployment. And so in practice, what this looks like is everybody commits to master. And then you have a web page you can go to see the uncode review commits. And anyone can pick one of those up. It works very, very similar to a branch-based model. But I'm looking at much smaller snippets. And I'm also not worrying about bugs, because it's already been deployed. It's probably been out there for 3 or 4 hours. Odds are I'm not going to find any bugs in that code. Another really good method that I like even more than reviewing individual commits is I don't know what your experience with code review is, but it's like 2/3 of the code reviews are nitpicks. And they're annoying nitpicks. Oh, you shouldn't have this space here in this if statement. You know, I would have used this other library function that's equivalent in every way, and I don't know why I'm telling you this, but it's my preference. I hate that type of code review. It's awful. So instead of doing that, do feature-level code review. Get to 2/3, 80% complete on a feature, close enough that you're like, yeah, we've got the architecture nailed, we've got everything working right, I think this is right. And then have another technical lead come in. I've seen this take place on a projector with the entire team in the room, where someone has sort of a blind read through of the code, and your goal is just explain the code to that person, walk them through it. And inevitably, you're going to come up with a bunch of issues. These are the important issues. These are the issues that you're going to hit a year from now when you go back and try and read this code and go, what was I thinking? Why is this organized this way? I don't understand it. That's the far more valuable use of code review. So higher level, looking at data flows instead of looking line by line, looking at features in an intelligent way, asking about the architecture. And better yet, if you can build this into your feature release system, you can say, okay, well, every time that we're about to release a feature, we're going to do a code review, and we're going to budget a day for fixing those things. Now, all of a sudden, you can build the feature slightly wrong and actually have the budget pre-built in to correct that. Because I don't know about you, but every single time I build a feature, I get to the end, and I'm like, well, that was slightly wrong. Because that's programming. The details matter, and you don't know the details until you actually do it. I wanted to tie all these things together. So it turns out that, I don't have a slide for this, unfortunately, code review slows down your latency. Service-oriented architecture gives you a bunch of deploy pipelines and slows down your latency. And continuous delivery, push-button deploys, slow down your latency. And all three work together in unison to cause organizations that claim to be doing continuous delivery having 2 or 3 week latencies between the time that someone's done writing code to the time that it's actually live and being run by users in production. And that is not continuous delivery. That was not what was intended. That is far from what we want. And so these anti-patterns unfortunately collude together to cause a lot of frustration. Everyone's like, well, we're doing all the right practices, all the right architecture practices, and also all the right continuous delivery practices, and then they don't mesh together. And so you need to avoid these three problems. I think I've given one form or another of this advice to every single company I have consulted with over the last 5 years. It is that common. People keep making the same mistakes. So if you get to continuous deployment, by far the most surprising thing about adopting it is that deployment is stress-free. When people hear about continuous deployment, they think about an extremely high-stress model. They think, every time I deploy right now, it's super stressful, and things go wrong, and we have postmortems, and it's awful. Why would I want to do that more? Why would I do that all the time? Even if it works, even if we don't have problems, like I'm going to be sweating nervously the whole time. And that's the general intuition, but it's just not true at all. The exact opposite is true. On your 100th deploy, you literally forgot that it deployed. You committed, and stuff just happened. It's all magic. It's incredibly stressful. It's easy to go, oh yeah, we have to push this hotfix. Well, that's fine. It's going to go through all of our normal deploy pipelines. Nothing special. I used to teach people at IMVU how to handle production outages, cluster failures that required code changes. The worst possible type of bug. And that's really hard to teach. You know, the first mistake people make is when they try and fix a higher priority bug where dollars are on the line, you have to write code with a gun to your head. You don't write a test. You don't follow your basic practices. And it turns out, you're probably going to screw up. Because you're under a lot of stress. things are going to go even worse. And so you say, no, 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 we always follow the process. It doesn't matter if it takes you 10 minutes extra. The company will pay for that lost revenue because you will probably do something better. You will probably not have that bug. You will probably push things out. So summing up sort of what I've learned from teaching continuous delivery, continuous deployment, continuous anything is great. Like, I'm not here to bag on continuous delivery. Sometimes you have to do something like that. If you're shipping an iOS app, you've got a gatekeeper, you can only deliver once a week. You know, automatic would be better, but I get it. I'm pragmatic. I also don't care what you call it. Most people say continuous delivery and continuous deployment, and they mean the same thing. I don't care. Language is living. I don't have a say in it anyway. But what I want you to take away from this is to have continuous deployment as your goal. To always be seeking the automated version. To always be continuing to try and deliver software with low latency. And to push back when people try and slow that down. Because if you don't set out this way, you will get stuck at roughly a 1 week delivery cycle. That is the pattern that I see over and over again. It doesn't matter how big your company is. It doesn't matter if you're a super well-funded startup or scrappy bootstrapping. It's the same problem everywhere. And now I'm out of a job as a consultant, so I guess this is my retirement speech. Okay, so now I'm going to switch gears. We went through basic stuff, intermediate stuff, and now I'm going to blather a little and hopefully it makes sense. So I'm going to talk about the future of continuous deployment. Really, that's the future of software. So just picking a project at random, I looked at a 2006 version of BuildBot, and the set of instructions were to manually go off, and they just listed these packages as requirements. You had to Google them. You had to figure out how to install them. It was all manual. We didn't have pip. I don't think we had easy install back then. From a Python perspective, there's no tooling. Contrast that with today. I'm working on a data warehouse project. This is a graph of the Python dependencies. There are 15 explicit dependencies, and those branch out. Each of those dependencies have dependencies which have dependencies that lead to 66 different things being integrated through a 5,000 line project. There's a huge explosion of integrations, and integrations that aren't within my organization. I can't tell any of these packages how to manage, how they work. I don't know how reliable they are at updating. I don't know how frequent. I don't know how much to trust them. I deleted, actually, which packages we had to pick specific versions of, because I didn't want to call out anyone. Everybody has a package manager. Even old languages that didn't have them are getting them very quickly, because everyone is stuck in the same boat, having to manage incredible complexity. Projects have more veterans, more libraries, more frameworks, more API integrations, more frequent deployments, more frequent needing to take updates from all of these things. And so what we're starting to see is the continuous deployment of things that you wouldn't traditionally consider standalone software packages. We're seeing continuous deployment of libraries, frameworks, operating systems. For example, Google Analytics. You say, please give me a Google Analytics. I know that it has this API, and we'll give you the latest code. Or an A/B experiment, or something else. You don't know. You don't care. It's out of your hands. We're even seeing this with operating systems. Via case slice uptrack, you can just say, auto apply updates. Give me hot fixes to my kernel, I don't care when, just do it. All of this is towards one goal, and that is to stop wasting time trying to keep up. Everything is changing faster and faster, and organizations are spending more and more time keeping up. If you really want a good example of this, look at JavaScript. JavaScript programmers, if they've been in the industry for more than 4 or 5 years, they all have the same fatigue. They've all been around the block and seen three different frameworks evolve and become the hottest thing and then die. And they've also watched their own marketability as a developer just fluctuate wildly. The problem with languages and frameworks when it comes to continuous deployment is they're inherently tightly coupled. And in fact, this ends up potentially killing whole languages. Perl 6, Python 3, we're now at like year 10 of the Python 3 transition. And I started a new project this year, Python 2, couldn't use Python 3. I was a huge evangelist for Python up until about 4 or 5 years ago when I realized that like it's kind of dying because this transition is so expensive. AngularJS is switching languages that it's written in. Ruby on Rails projects that are more than 3 or 4 years old, you should just rewrite them. Actually upgrading is too complex. This is a huge problem for our industry that we're going to have to face. So here's my big prediction. The next big language and or framework, the winner will be whoever can sustain evolution across organizations, across integrations, across platforms. And that's a big shift from the current paradigm, which is whoever has the best marketing pitch, whoever shows me the best like static code examples, that's what I want to use. Now, organizations are starting to get smart enough. I don't know what the timeline is on this. It might be 5 years, it might be 15. You know, I'm only mostly perfect at predicting the future, so. So what would that look like? Here's a hypothetical. What if your programming language had built-in support for code migration so that your frameworks and your libraries, when they updated, when they made a breaking change to their API, they could ship with it a little snippet of code that could update your code to work with the new API. Now obviously there are cases where this doesn't work. But you'd be surprised how much time and effort and stress and frustration goes into like changing the casing on an accidentally miscased class in Python. Like some of those changes had to wait for the Python 3 rewrite. Uh-huh. So what would that look like? Imagine you write in a tiny little language that says, okay, well we're renaming old class to new class, or we're changing a signature, or we're adding a new parameter, and here's a default, so if the calling site doesn't have anything to specify there, it just automatically becomes null. And we're seeing a little of this right now. So 6.py is a library designed just to help this transition between Python 2 to Python 3. And in Go, you have Go format, which most people just use to pass it through your code and it automatically makes it look correct. They have a single correct version of how the white space should be. However, it's actually also a really good tool. You can pass it crazy command line arguments and automatically do refactorings. And you'll see in the release notes every once in a while for Go, hey, we changed this minor thing, we don't think it's a big deal if you run this Go format line, that fixes it. And I've seen people share, hey, we updated this project, there's a Go format line that fixes it. What I propose is that these are going to become not just standard, but built into the way that we build and develop software. And overall, this is all pointing to one trend, which is to prioritize change in code over the static code. I don't care about your 10,000 lines of code. I care about the 10 lines of code I want to add to it. I care about the refactorings and how they integrate with other people's changes. We're in a world where if I actually counted up the number of developers on my 5,000 line project, if I looked at all the open source contributors and all the contributions and all the patches and changes, it grows to be beyond the comprehension of any one individual. And that's a small project. Can you imagine an operating system? This focus on change, I think, is going to revolutionize our industry. I don't know how, I don't know what form, but I'm really interested, and I'm excited.